Hi, this is Brendan Davis from Bedrock Games and the Bedrock Blog, and I'm here with Joel and Adam for another day of the 12 Days of Fistmas. This is in celebration of various projects that Joel is working on. Joel, do you have a project that you want to talk about before we get into the movie we're going to discuss?
Oh, heck yeah, because we're coming up on my next Kickstarter number two, kind of technically number three, but we're going to call it number two. We're not going to count the failed Kickstarter. So Acid and Steel, it's another Lone Wolf Fist project. It's a continuation and a broadening of the setting. We're going to give you a robot world called Babel Kaminar, where you could play a new type of hero, artificial hero, and get robot parts grafted onto you RoboCop style. Thanks for the inspiration there, Adam. But yeah, it's kind of fun. It's very loosely based on stuff like Battle Angel Alita and things like that, Armitage the Third, some of the more cyberpunk elements of Akira, that kind of thing. And it also additionally has Naraka, which I finally explored all of that. So you could be a prince of hell and get demonic Ashura powers and do all kinds of great stuff in the heavy metal acid hell of the setting. And Kickstarter is coming up soon. It was going to be a February thing, but my writing for it has been delayed by a couple of things, so it's probably going to be a little bit later. We're going to have the writing done before we do the Kickstart, so that'll be nice. Should be a pretty quick little thing. And we just been getting cover returns from our fantastic Rockstar artist, Kazuki, and they are looking really, really rad. I've showed them off earlier to Adam and Brendan to a round of mild applause. But yeah, so look forward in the very near future to being able to go to hell and back in Acid and Steel. So that's my plug.
And today we're doing Fist of the North Star, and I don't know what day of the 12 Days of Fist was for.
No,
I
idea.
Lost track. We've but we're all lost somewhere the towards the end. We know that. But we're doing Fist of the North Star, which is a 1986 Japanese animation film directed by Toyo Ashida. After a nuclear war turns Earth into a lawless wasteland, Kenshiro, a practitioner of a deadly martial art, Hokuto Shinken, is that correct? Fights a succession of tyrannical warriors to restore order. That was from the IMDb. That sounds fairly accurate to me based on what I saw. Right. I don't know that I have the most accurate read of this movie. But I think that resembles what I saw last night.
Well, I'm the one who drug you both into this film.
Yes, you did. Yes, you did. So, all right. So why don't we round table it and everybody can give their first impressions and then we can go into, and also if you have personal experience with this movie, you can talk about that, but that and your overall first impression.
All right. I mean, am I going first? I feel like one of you guys should go first. Everyone knows that I love this movie.
Go first. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
All right. Fight, you two. Fight. Only the strongest can give their opinion.
I'll go. I had never seen this. It's a movie I've heard about going back to the 80s, but it's just never really crossed my path. I know that it's a super it was a really violent post-apocalyptic kung fu type anime movie thing. I got to admit, I struggled a little bit early in this movie. I wasn't sure I was going to like it. Because it being a manga condensed down to a movie, a lot of the early scenes felt, you know, I felt like there was kind of jumping from one thing to another with different characters. And it took me a little while to get into the art style and animation style. And then maybe about a third of the way through the movie, it just started to click. And it's got a very mythic quality, you know, kind of in that sense, when you go back and read old myths, they're very general, very, you know, not written in a very specific style we expect of, you know, modern fiction. It just kind of clicked as kind of this mythological type story for me. And I really started to enjoy it. It's like because I watched it pretty late last night. And I was like, okay, I'm going to watch like maybe an hour of this, you know, now, and I'll watch the second hour tomorrow or something. And it's like, no, I'm going to watch the whole thing. I was just like, I'm on board. I'm going to watch it. And
once it gets fists into you. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly. It's like, I really enjoyed this by the end. I'm really glad you suggested this. It, like I said, it took a little work. I had to meet it halfway early on, but once I was on board, I just thoroughly enjoyed the rest of the movie.
Excellent.
So, yeah, like Adam, I don't think I had seen this one before either. It's possible because there were, we saw like a lot of animes and a lot of different types of movies like this when I was younger. And this was definitely like Adam, this is a name I remember hearing. Mm-hmm. And I had this feeling that maybe I had seen it, but nothing that I saw last night was anything I recognized. So I'm going to assume that I didn't see it. And if I did, it was just like, you know, one of those one and done kind of things where it just, you know, you saw it and then you never really remembered it. But I liked the ending. I'll start there. I liked the ending. The ending entertained me. And I know that I'm probably going to be the least popular person on this podcast tonight because I know this is a very popular movie. And I don't think there's anything wrong with the movie. I think it's a well done movie. Like when it opens up and it's doing those animated sequences of the landscape, I was like, oh, this is 1986 and they're doing some fairly, advanced, you know, foreground imagery with the you know what I mean? That sort of thing where, there was an artistry to it. It has an aesthetic and it commits to that aesthetic. And for me, I think what it boils down to, I don't dislike anime. I'm not a big anime person though. So it takes, like my wife is always trying to get me to watch animated movies or anime or whatever. And I just will stubbornly refuse. She talked me into Kung Fu Panda the other night. And I couldn't watch more than 20 minutes of it. Like I just can't sit through animated films. This is
very
film.
Similar to Kung Fu Panda, so yeah. I can see.
Yeah. Yeah. No. I'm not saying this is like Kung Fu Panda. It's the fact that when I'm in an animated film, I feel trapped. I don't
if
like
your kids like Kung Fu Panda. Just show them this; they're gonna love it.
Yeah, Kung Fu Panda is the first feature. Second feature.
The reason I mentioned Kung Fu Panda is Kung Fu Panda is generally thought of as an easy enough movie to watch. It's mainstream.
Did you get to the Tai Lung scene? I think you'd enjoy that scene.
Well, what? So where the tiger?
Yeah, where the tiger is just kicking ass and busting out of the.
I should say we didn't watch the first. I'd seen the first one ages ago. We watched like Kung Fu Panda 3 or 4, whatever they're up to now. That's what I watched, and I was not enjoying myself. I'll put it that way. And so that's something to understand. This is a perfectly fine anime. It has its own style of anime, but I really didn't enjoy watching it. It was very difficult for me to sort of marshal through. Like normally, even when I don't like a movie, it's like, okay, I got to watch the movie. And this one, it was like, oh man, like, is this going to be over soon? And it wasn't because there was anything wrong with the movie. It's just that I really felt trapped in this aesthetic that I did not want to be trapped in.
That's how I felt for the first half hour. So I totally know what you're saying.
Okay.
It took me a while. Then it just flipped on me and I was like, oh, I get it now. But yeah.
Yeah. I don't even like movies like heavy metal and stuff like that. Like, you know, those kind of things don't really appeal to me. I remember seeing them as a kid and I have negative memories of seeing the Phantom Toll Booth is another one where I get physically nauseous when I think of that movie. So,
I think for me, part of the issue I was having too is like so many of those early scenes, it's almost all entirely hostility for like the early part of the movie. There's like no there's like no relationships that are in any way positive for like the early part of the movie. And so there was just no in. I like wasn't feeling drawn into a character to relate to or to anything. And it's like when Rei and Kenshiro kind of team up to go rescue that Rei's blinded sister. That was where the movie just started to pull me in. I was like, okay, I found kind of a rooting interest in the movie, and I was actually invested. And that whole sequence I really enjoyed, and I just enjoyed the rest of the movie from that point forward. So
yeah, their bro energy is really, really good. I will say that. First of all, I only like Rei as a character.
Yeah, no, Rei was a great character. Right? Like I said, that was where it was always kind of brooding, strong, silent people being jealous of each other, and that was just
that wasn't the part that bothered me. Like that stuff, I was fine with. It was just more the aesthetic and the confusion. I was really having a hard time following what was going on.
Me too.
And also
one thread that really unites it super well. I'll give you that.
And it's also the style of anime action that I dislike the most out of anime action. So it's and again, for what it does that well. It's just that it's like, I like the thing where he's like kicking the guy in the stomach a million times and opening up the stomach. Like that's the that kind of stuff always bugged me when I was younger and we would watch anime movies. You know, it's just not my cup of tea is more the situation. But there were things that I liked about it, like, and also things that puzzled me. And some of it might have had to do with the confusion because, you know, I didn't really understand a lot of what was going on.
Yeah, a lot of the physics of this movie really plays by its own rules. Like well, that yeah. stomach scene is that's a weird one because he's kicking in the stomach and he makes like a vortex in his fat. Then the guy grabs the edges of the vortex and tries to push it back together, and he just can't do it. It's like, what force is keeping that vortex going? Like, is that just part of his kicking magic? Like, what's going on here?
Yeah, I desperately wanted to understand some of the rules of what was going on. Now, I did like the way they handled internal injuries. I thought that was cool.
Yeah,
I like that.
I read the guy who wrote the original manga. He was reading a lot of stuff about Chinese kind of pressure point, like a Dianju type kung fu. That was his big influence for this because he thought he liked the idea that it could be a guy who could fight much larger opponents because he just had this kind of pressure point technique. So
yeah, I thought that was cool. I thought that was cool. I liked that there was a martial world present, that there was this, I didn't understand the full geography of it, but I liked that there was a geography underlaying all this. Sorry about that. And I liked that the way that it ended, I was still thinking about after I saw the movie because I was like, wait a second, she's up on a cross there. So I mean, it's like blatant. It's blatant. Like it's not like some movies where it's vague. Like they briefly go into Jesus pose and then it's done. This was like she's up on a cross and then she like did she vanish? Like I don't understand what happened. She's like she does. I didn't see her die unless I missed something. Maybe I missed that. So she kind of becomes like this phantom person that he's chasing in the end, it seems.
Yeah, she leaves. It's not clear in the movie what's going on with that. She just kind of vanishes into myth, and Kin just kind of goes with her.
So here was what my brain stitched together was, oh, well, she was crucified and she died, and the sacrifice is what brought back all of the foliage that started to grow in the world. Which I thought was kind of a cool idea, even if it's literally. So,
It is in
the manga. She dies way earlier. I think she commits suicide in the Southern Cross City that Shin has her in, and then Kin and Shin have a showdown. Rao's not involved in it. They fight.
Okay.
And after she's killed herself, and Shin's completely in despair, and he's like had his lowest point, and Kenshiro, not knowing this, kills him, and then he's like, oh yeah, and Julia's dead, and so. Yeah, Kin kind of loses that driving, like, motivation, and the question becomes, like, well, what's his purpose now in this new world? That's why in that fight with Rao at the end, what's the little kid's name? Damn it, I can't remember. I really look like an idiot, I remember her name. But whenever she comes up to stop the fight, that's supposed to be, like, she kind of inherited that purpose from Julia because she has her seeds and all of that. So it's a stronger thematic tie in the manga. In the movie, it's just like, well, where did Julia go?
yeah,
that's what I was thinking. So it's like, well, she went away, and then flowers appear. So there's like a causal.
I will say the crucifixion thing in Japan is more complicated too, because it was just a thing Japanese people did. Like I know in World War II, a lot of Japanese Australian prisoners of war, the Japanese got crucified. I know that was a thing I remember from my childhood. So it could be Christian symbolism, but it might just be. This is a form of capital punishment in Japan.
Okay.
So it's tough to say.
There's a famous painted image from the manga of Kin on this kind of weird. It's not really a cross, but it's kind of the same thing where he's like more or less being crucified on this thing. So it's a recurring symbol. And it's
maybe it is.
I mean, like it kind of goes back to. Like, is this being directly influenced by Christian symbolism, or is this being influenced by Mad Max, which was influenced by Christian symbolism?
You do have you got a point. It does show up in Mad Max as well. Good point. Or Road Warrior. least.
Now, the other thing I did like, or I found interesting, was the relationships between the characters were more complicated than they initially appear in, like, those scenes Adam was talking about. So,
yeah, they seem like almost insultingly puerile in the first few times you see them. Like, Shin and Ken have, like, this, like, schoolyard bully thing where Shin's like, I'll beat you up and take your girlfriend.
Yeah.
And that's his motive. But then later on, you realize that he's been corrupted by Jaggy, and he's turned into a maniac as he's seen the world fall apart. And, like, there's all this nuance to it that wasn't, like, it's not clear in the initial scene.
I liked the Jaggy sort of worm tongue thing that they had. Also, that's a very Mad Max character, too, because he's like Goose from Mad Max. You know, he's been burned, and so, or whatever it was that happened to him. I don't remember what that was, but...
let's go with deformed somehow. Yeah. He's been,
He went through a lot, but he was this weird jester like character that was like, you know, egging people on to sow discord. And it was, and so I did like that. There were, so again, I struggled to watch the movie. I would get lost. I'd be like, wait, who is this person? What are they doing? Like, why, where did this person go? Like, I was really getting lost. So I'm not going to be able to, competently talk about characters by name, but like, Was Rao the big guy, right?
Rao's like the big guy on the horse.
Yeah. And is he literally Kenshiro's brother, or are they just
Marshall Brothers? Okay. Yeah, because they refer to the sensei as their father. That's not their dad.
Okay.
Like, none of them look alike. I think they're all just part of that Marshall school.
I like that kind of a backstory where you have these people that are all rooted in the same school, and it flowers into this conflict. And I really liked the Shin character. Like, at first I hated him. I was like, this guy's not a good character. Like, he's just over the top in every possible way. But then you get this more romantic soul that emerges midway through the movie when they're fighting. And also Ken isn't even really that interested in killing him or anything. Like, that's I was expecting him to want to come for revenge against him. That's what I thought the movie was going to be about. And so when he comes there and he's like, I don't really want to hurt you. And
Give me my lady and we'll just go our separate ways. Yeah, like, well, and that's the thing. There's a certain purity to the Ken in the movie. In the manga and in the anime, that's not the case. He comes for blood. He's very changed by the time he meets Shin again. And this one, he sort of retains his purity, though, which I think is a fascinating change.
I mean, if that's the difference, I like this better. I think this that they went a better direction here.
The movie made some very interesting artistic choices. That was one of them that I really liked.
Almost like Shin almost seemed like a Lord Byron type character to me.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? I was just like, oh, this guy, he's just like so in love. And he's just like, the line where I forget what he said, but he's like, only madmen can love and hate is with the depth that you do. Something like that.
The words he says over Shin's dead body is like, you loved her more than I did because you're a maniac. Yeah.
And so it was just a very romantic movie, and romantic in like the traditional sense of the word, not in the sense of like, romance between two characters.
Yeah, there's a lot of that. There's a lot of clashes of philosophy, and the themes that emerge are really fascinating. You know, the whole like conquest and nihilism versus using the same kind of power. So all from the same martial school to protect this like fragile flower of hope that's trying to blossom. Yeah. It's really interesting. It winds up being a deeper and more nuanced movie than I think that it gets credit for. And I was noticing that on this viewing, too, where it was like, usually whenever I watch Fist of the North Star, I'm like, look, I just want to see a guy get punched and his head explode. That's what I'm here for. But it never leaves you with that. It's always like, no, you're going to sit your ass down. You're going to learn why they're punching. And we're going to give you the name of the technique and why their head explodes. So, like, and the manga does a really good job of, like, and the anime do, too, where it will, like, freeze frame when their head explodes and tell you what particular martial arts move he just used to make his head explode. Okay. That's a lot of fun. That kind of hokiness is unfortunately missing from the movie.
But that's hard to capture in a movie, but yeah, I get that.
The Shaw Brothers can do it because they're sorcerers. Like, it's...
But if you watch Brave Archer versus if you read the Legend of Condor Hero books, the level of detail that it gets into in all the various martial arts is so much deeper than in the movie, because the movie can't give you all that. Even though it might name them by name, it's not giving you the depth. And so I can appreciate how these would be different. What I want to know is is Rao the name of the character? I keep forgetting how to
pronounce it. Yeah, he's the guy that works
Yeah.
The Fisk. The
only his change of heart at the end, I was very curious about, because I didn't fully understand it.
I found it really, really fascinating. That was go ahead. I didn't mean to cut you off, Brenda.
No. I mean, that's sort of what I was thinking, is that it was just like this guy who's been like, I don't know what you would call it, but just like a very unreasonable person the whole way through the movie, right? Like he didn't he kill his master or
kill his master?
Yeah, he killed his master, and he blatantly did not follow his master's like commands, his
wishes, or teachings, or anything. And it went off to conquer the world.
Yeah. And he just is like, so, you know, power is all that matters. And then he has this one moment where this girl just, she doesn't even really say anything to him. She's just like, can you please stop? Like, you know, and then she says something that is, I don't know if she said it or if he hears his master's voice because he's talking to her, but the master says something about perception. And there's like this Zen-like moment where he suddenly perceives her importance and Ken's importance. And I thought that was the only way I could really wrap my head around it.
You got it. I think that's exactly it.
Yeah, I like the whole element, too, of just his idea of the age. You know, it's like he rules this age of the apocalypse thing. And it's kind of, she's kind of, just, she's kind of the embodiment of what's going to come after the age of the apocalypse. Mm. Going from saying that kind of mythic feel the movie had, I felt that really, really played into that a lot. It's like these mythical figures as much as they were people to an extent.
And maybe his head, remember at some point Shin is commenting on that, like how it's just going to be a dead planet with like nothing on it, you know, except the bodies. And I think maybe he was in that same mindset until he realized, oh, there's a child and there's hope and that. So but I thought that was a good ending. Like that was, and also I like that he kind of, I don't know, it's like his whole dynamic with Ken changed after that moment where, you know.
Well, there's the moment earlier too, this just kind of popped into my head when he's kind of doing the parade down the street and Lynn kind of watches and he just stops and looks at her for 30 seconds or so and moves on. I feel like that's almost the beginning. It's like that thought is forming in his head at that point, you know, of like, there might be a future. Maybe this nihilism I've embraced isn't actually reality. I've kind of poisoned myself. I don't know. That's just.
No, that makes sense.
Popped into my head.
But again, you know, I was very confused. I was very, I was bitching. I'll admit, I was bitching the whole time. I was bitching to my wife about.
God damn it! Gotta watch this. Yeah. I'm gonna kill Joel tomorrow.
No, I wasn't mad at Joel. I was just like, my God, like, you know, just I was just because she kept saying, "What do you want?" Because she kept accusing. She always accuses me of watching a porno whenever she hears a movie where somebody is like screaming in any way, and so I was like, "No, I'm not watching a porno. I'm watching this anime." About, you know, and I couldn't tell her what it was like. I don't know.
You don't watch cartoons with me. How come you're watching cartoons with Joel?
Yeah. I invited her to watch with me. I said, hey, I want to watch this anime for my podcast. Will you watch it with me? And she was like, no, I don't want to watch that. So,
I can't see it being
it's not really a chick flick. Yeah. And there's little to recommend it to the fair sex, I'm afraid. It really is like, it's so testosterone fueled. I mean, like, and that's fine. A movie can be that, you know, a lot of movies I like are, they have that kind of richness to them where they kind of appeal to humanity in general. This one isn't. This is like, no, we're all yin. We're not doing the yang with this one. This is all fists, baby. But yeah, I'm so glad I got to torment you, Brendan. This just made my entire week.
I mean, just give me a moment. It wasn't torture. It's just that like I was groggy. I was tired. I was like, man, do I really? You know, like anime is not my thing. I can work my way through a live action movie. Do you know what I mean? You know, at 11 at night, no problem. But anime is a lot harder for me. I used to watch anime when I was younger, but I did kind of make a conscious choice around 2000, 2001, where I was like, I'm just going to watch live action movies. I'm not going to watch animated ones anymore.
watched Ninja Scroll with me.
I did, and I like Ninja Scroll better than this.
Ninja Scroll's a madhouse brush. It's absolutely beautiful. And there are versions of this. Like, there's other Fist of the North Star movies that have much more, they're much more digestible. Their plots are a lot more, they're not as broad as this one is. The animation's a lot slicker. The animation here actually reminded me of the original Vampire Hunter D. I don't know if you guys have seen that one.
No, that's another one I like. I like Vampire Hunter D.
That's a fantastic film.
There are anime movies that I really remember and like. It's just that but some of them get into that Phantom Tollbooth territory for me, where the aesthetic makes me, it like almost makes me physically uncomfortable somehow. Here's how I'll put it.
It's like it was designed to do that.
When I was a kid,
there's a lot of gross in this movie. Like,
no, not that.
It's like that.
That's not what I'm talking about. I'm talking about the aesthetic, not the bloodshed. I'm fine with bloodshed. Bloodshed doesn't bother me.
But even just when they're standing still, there's something grotesque about their proportions, about the lines they put in their faces. Like, the whole thing.
That was part of my
issue
early on. It's like, I, as someone that draws, that's done a lot of life drawing of people and stuff, it's like I had to get, it's like, this is, it's so wrong. But I kind of got used to it over the course of the movie.
It was more the color palette for me. Then,
that was pretty nauseating too.
Yeah, I'll give it that to was you. What really, and that's what gave me the Phantom Toll. Not that it had the same color palette as Phantom Tollbooth, but had that same, like, I feel like I'm watching pea soup. Like, it was a very, I don't know quite how to describe it, but it felt...
You're right. You're absolutely correct there. But remember, they're contrasting that with those bookend shots of, like, the beautiful, you know, serene world, which don't have that palette. They're completely different. And so they stand out really big as scenes. So you do kind of have to force your way through the aesthetic visuals of the movie. They are grim.
It is an ugly movie. It's like deliberately so. I mean, you just have to kind of accept that.
It is. It's a deliberately ugly movie. Because with animation, like, this isn't like filming on a set or a location where you have a lot of control, but not all control, because it's the reality of where you're filming matters. Here, you have control of everything on every frame. Absolute control. And they consciously decided to make this gruesome to look at, right? Just hard on your eyes, displeasing browns and yellows and oranges, this nauseating palette. I love it.
It's not even that it's a barren landscape. It's that it's a barren landscape and they chose this particular tone to use it, that pea soup tone. It doesn't look like pea soup, but I'm just going to use pea soup to describe any tone that captures that.
It is that it's almost like a vomit color scheme.
Yeah.
There's just something gross and sickly about it.
But then on top of that, there's like these bright, like you were saying, these bright oranges and reds and blues that feel, I just didn't like looking at it.
I agree with you. It's nauseating.
And so I when I'm in an animated movie like that, I just feel trapped. I feel like, man, I want to get out of this thing. And it's like, and also, you know what it looked like? It had kind of a video game palette to it. Like, not like it was pixelated, but a similar palette to a video game.
A lot of the sequences in this reminded me of those cutscenes you'd get in, like, you know, coin-op Japanese games.
And again, I'm not a big video game person either. So that's another, you know, like, and one of the reasons why I'm not is I don't like the feeling of being trapped in a video game for hours on end. I feel like I'm in this place I don't want to be. Like
in a dungeon, like a real elf game level.
No, I just don't like, I remember I used to like Zelda as a kid, you know, that, but like, if you put me in front of a screen with Zelda for an hour, I would just be miserable. That's just not a world I want to be in. When I see people playing Warhammer, what is it? Not Warhammer. What's the game that everybody
Warcraft
plays?
Is what you're thinking
Warcraft.
About. Yeah.
People haven't played
that for a decade, but okay.
Okay. Well, what's the new game that everybody's playing? What's the new hotness?
Fortnite is very hot.
Okay. Yeah. I haven't played Fortnite, but I can guarantee you I'd probably feel entrapped or entombed if I were watching it.
I really like that you bring that up, that feeling of being trapped. That isn't universal to all animated movies for you, but it's something that this one very much, because I think I know what you're talking about, because when you watch this, you do, even more so than Mad Max, which kind of makes you feel trapped. Mm-hmm. Like, at least Mad Max has blue skies. This one doesn't. It's like you're in a prison of rotting meat. Like,
yeah.
Yeah, you're in the inside of a microwave set on low and everything's dying. It really feels claustrophobic and sickly.
It was the color palette and the angles. The angles were not giving me any sense that I was escaping from this thing that I wanted to get out of. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah,
and I wasn't.
And this ever more confined, nauseating place.
Well,
it's a big difference between it and the Mad Max movies, of course, is that Mad Max is set in very wide open spaces. And this, you tend to be in these urban environments where you're always hemmed in by these collapsing buildings all around you all the time.
Yeah, I was the angles and the color were very. Two things that really stuck out at me while I was watching it. The angles, I remember having a very strong reaction to. But again, it's not, like I said, it's not a bad movie. I'm not critiquing it because I know it's not.
What a fascinating reaction. Because like, I also experienced that to some degree as well. Like I saw it as a general part of the, they clearly were going for that, right? Because we all got some of that out of the movie. You know, the angles are kind of meant to evoke that, you know, the colors are meant to evoke that, the choice of environments and just how collapsing and miserable at everything, it's meant to evoke that. So again, I feel like it does a good job of driving home the kind of wacky cartoonish villains who like, because they're so motivated by nihilism that it's kind of like, it's ludicrous, right? But when you get to, when you start to watch the movie and you realize just how crapsack their world is, you're like, well, okay, yes, but you know, they're not entirely wrong. Look where they live.
I mean, to take it back to Road Warrior again, it's like, you know, Road Warrior, and that the way Max is continually blowing off the kid, wants nothing to do with the kid, you know, it's like the feral kid wants to go along with him. He's just like, nah. And it's like, well, Max watched it, didn't watch, but his own child died, and the last thing he wants is to have some kid tagging along with him that he's going to be responsible for going off into the wasteland and having to look after. And it's like I was a kid watching, when I'd watched that movie, it felt like Max was kind of being a jerk. As an adult, I'm like, yeah, I understand the weight of what,
well, when you're a kid, you're the kid, right? But when you're an adult, you're Max, and you're like, oh, God, kid, I don't want to feed you.
Yeah, guys, can you talk for just a few minutes without me? I just have to go tend to something real quick.
We can't talk without you. Don't.
We're all going to sit here in stoic silence until Brendan returns. Starting now. 1, 2, 3, go.
Yeah, but you're saying, like you say, the nihilism makes a lot more sense when you're in a post-apocalyptic environment than it does when we're, you know, sitting here comfortably watching the movie.
Yeah, they kind of, it's interesting. I really like the villains in this movie. First of all, like, it's condensing a lot from the original source material, but it does a good job of highlighting what makes them unique and giving you some insight into their motivations a lot. I really like Jaggy as, like, the source of the big rift that happens between everybody, because he's just this small, petty, jealous, miserable person. I like him a lot. He's a simple motivation, but it's good. I like the way it manifests, you know? It's conniving. I think Brendan called him a worm tongue character. Perfect. I really like Shin, like, descending into nihilism, but being convinced that he can just grab this one last thing he wants in Julia before the bitter end. And he makes, like, a paradise for her, you know, because he's, like, he's weak to that kind of thing, being the Lord Byron kind of romantic. And then Rao is an interesting villain, too, because he also succumbs to nihilism, but, like, I don't know, there's something kind of dutiful about Rao, where he's, like, it's part of his, like, greater destiny or purpose to be the kind of person he is. Like, in a lot of ways, he kind of gets some of the important aspects of whatever it means to be the Fist of the North Star. And I really like that point you guys are making, where it isn't until he understands the dying words of his master that he really kind of, like, he's a complete as a character, you know? He's really strong, and he even beats Kinshiro in the theatrical cut of this, which is clearly the superior version. But, like, he's made complete by the realization that there was something vital that he was missing, and not being able to kind of sense this other aspect of his own character, you know? And I like that. I like that he wins, and he's the champion of the nihilism apocalypse, and he's like, oh, wait, this didn't matter. Nihilism doesn't go anywhere. But there is a kid here, and there is a flower here, and there is there is maybe a future here. And now that I get that, I'm going to go and pay my respects at my master's grave. And then he just leaves. He's done. He's done what he can do. I like that a lot. I also like that he realizes that for all his strength, he's not designed to protect the future. You know, so he's just like, he does one of those like wuxia superhero things. Like, what was it? Bride with White Hair, where the guy goes to watch the rose grow for like 20 years or whatever.
It's kind of
that, where he's just like, whenever Kenshiro heals from his crippling mortal wounds, which he eventually will in years, I will still be paying my respects to my dead master. You can just find me there. I love that. That's such a wuxia thing to do.
Yeah,
I filled up that entire time that you were gone by just.
No, that's cool. That's cool.
welcome to hearing me talk about Fist of the
North. What do we think of the difference between the two different endings? Because, like I said, I saw the theatrical version. I think Joel, you saw the theatrical version. Adam, it sounds like you saw both, right? Did you see both?
Yeah, like I said, I enjoyed the ending enough though that I was like, oh, I'm going to go watch the other ending right now. I kind of fast forwarded through the other version, got to the ending, and I totally missed what was different because I was tired. I looked it up online, like, oh, that's what's different. Okay, because I was thinking it was like a little later in the movie. By the ending, I was thinking, oh, it's something after the big fight, and I was like, everything's the same. But it's very close
to the other movie.
Also, yeah. What did you guys watch, the English or the Japanese audio?
Japanese,
yeah. I watched the English.
I watched the English.
Why would you do that?
Because I wanted to understand everything that they were saying, and I didn't want to have to read late at night.
It's different. The story's different in the English version.
Is it? Okay.
I don't know what they changed, but I read that. I read that there are significant plot changes.
Okay, well, that might be part of why I was confused. For anything visual, I will usually set it to English the first time I watch it so I can focus on the action a little bit. Because I have trouble reading subtitles and following action.
I will say the American dubbing on the version I watched was very good. Like, they got really good voice actors and they knew what movie they were in. But they still they turned in great performances. So I'll give them that. I love how seriously the Japanese voice cast took this movie. I feel like there's a little bit of a smirk with the American voice cast. Like, there's even some moments where it's supposed to be comedic and like they understand, they got the comedy, that's kind of delightful. Like whenever Rao was fighting that guy, he can turn his skin into steel. And he just like, he hits him and he's like, they have this moment before he dies where he's like, why are you just going to punch me? That's not a big deal. I'm just going to stand here for a second. No, I'm going to get, then he gets flown back. I love that moment. Yeah. That's such a beautiful comedy moment. And the voice actors do a great job of that. Also, whoever they got to voice that guy sounded a lot like the Shredder.
I looked up the names and they were all people that I've seen this guy in this show. Like one of them was a guy that was in Babylon 5, or one of them was somebody who like voiced in movies or cartoons that I had seen growing up. They were all working actors, you know what I mean?
So they got a good cast. Like, so it's not like the English version is like some terrible travesty. It's just, man, it is dead serious when the Japanese cast does it. I don't know how they managed to keep that straight laced.
I like listening to Japanese. It's just a language that, you know, some languages just particularly appeal to me when I'm listening to them. So for me, it was an easy choice. I'm like, oh, I'm going to listen to this in Japanese. And it really suited the tone of the movie for me. But I'm not sure what the specifics are different in what we saw, but most of what you're saying agrees with everything I feel. So maybe it's
not the broad stroke.
The other thing is, when I was younger and when I was watching this stuff, I came in from the time when we had like VHS tapes of it. Yep. And I'm sure some of them were Japanese with subs, but I remember most of them being dubbed because that's how I remember most of the shows was being dubbed.
Yeah. Most of my original animes that I would watch on the Sci-Fi channel or on VHS were dubbed. Like, because they didn't have the technology to just do the movie twice on the same thing. With the original Japanese audio, they would just dub it. And that's fine. You know, it had its own aesthetic. Like, and this particular movie, this one, Vampire Hunter D, there's a couple of them, Rojin Z. I kind of feel like the dubs are superior aesthetically because of just how they give something to the movie that it didn't have in the Japanese
Cowboy
version.
Bebop. There's one that's got a good dubbed version. I prefer the dubbed version of Cowboy Bebop.
Yeah, that's the one anime where I'll 100% agree with you. The Cowboy Bebop dub is unrivaled. The mm-hmm. American voice cast isn't, well, yeah, actually, I eat my words there. The Trigun one is really good, too. But yeah, no, that one's incredible. Especially the guy that got to play Spike. I know he's done other stuff. What is his name? I know it's something, it's like Bloom or something like that. But that guy
Valentine, too. Jill Valentine. I find the English version so much better. It's just the Japanese version is just kind of the traditional Japanese kind of anime voice, whereas the English version, I feel, has a real personality to it.
Well, that kind of came out of the same philosophy that the Batman animated series had with voice acting, where they didn't want people doing voices, they want people whose voices had character. And so that's where you get your legendary, like, Kevin Conroy turns as Batman and things like that. Same exact thing. They were right-fitting actors to roles, and which is what you're supposed to do. And it did gangbusters. Like, the voices were incredible. Nowadays, with anime dubs, it feels like they just have, like, a stable of dub artists, and that's who they grab. I don't know if they unionized or what happened, but...
Yeah, you see the same voices all the time, same actors all the time. There is just a tiny group of... These are the voice actors anime fans like, so we're going to hire them so we can put their name on the box. People go, oh, this person's doing the dub. I'm going to watch it.
It's like watching the old Shaw Brothers. They get the they have like a crew of like five people, it seems, that all do the voices.
And they do like Lord's Prayer.
I think there's something very interesting about dubs where it becomes a new artifact when you dub it rather than do the sub. And if you grew up on that artifact, that's sort of an interesting thing. Like the movie Snake in the Eagle's Shadow with Jackie Chan. I think I've seen a sub version at some point, but when I got it, it was dubbed, and I don't think I want to see it subbed. I prefer the humor of some of the strength. There's like a scene where there's this priest who's wandering around the whole movie, and you just think he's a priest, and he's a Westerner. He looks like he's from Europe or Russia or something, and he's just kind of an annoying priest the whole time. And it turns out, no, he's like a secret martial art expert. And the guy who's playing him is like, I'm a fighter from Russia. And the way he says it, it's like just the right tone of bad that it makes the line super funny. And that's how I always want that scene to play. Because I'm sure if it was if I saw the subs, I'd be disappointed with how it landed at this point.
I concur. There is a piece of culture there that is unique to the subculture of Americanized anime. So
it's like bootleg culture. It's like if you grew up watching bootlegs of martial art movies or something. Yeah.
Those animated movies have the advantage that it's not as obvious when something is dubbed as it is when you're watching live action stuff too.
Go ahead.
I wanted to say the phrase, yes, that's true, and agree with Adam.
When I was still watching anime, the big debate that I remember my friends having, which was probably pretty provincial, I'm sure, like online forums, this would seem like, oh, you know, but our big debate was whether when they have like a character that's from a rural part of Japan, whether it was appropriate to give them like an American rural accent versus a non, you know what I mean? Like,
Islander or something like that.
I think that is a good thing to do a lot of times. I mean, I'll do similar things. I mean, as someone that runs role playing games, when you're doing, it's like, it acts like official advice in Warhammer that they have, like, is, oh, you know, do kind of do that. What's your big city accent? What's your rural accent? Because, it's like, I can't do a million different German accents that are all going to suggest something, or a million Japanese accents. Yeah. It's like, it's outside my capacity. All I can do is the same tone all the time if I don't do that.
My Scottish ancestors, I cannot do a brogue for the life of me. There's a couple I can really nail, but not the Scottish brogue, not at all.
But even if you could nail it, if you're doing a campaign set in Scotland, it's like, would you want to break that same brogue out for every character? You're not going to be able to get the nuance like of actual individual Scottish.
It's to the point that like the audience in question are Americans, or, you know, in our case, two Americans and an Australian. But like it's, you know, people that have a particular, you know, we have certain expectations of what this accent means versus that. Like when I run a Wuxia campaign set in a Chinese setting, I don't know what an urban you know, sophisticated Chinese accent is versus a rural accent or versus. So, you know, yeah. I have to draw. So I'll draw on things like, OK, I might use a vaguely New Yorkish accent for this character or yeah, use something more, you know, yeah. like a more like this guy sounds like he went to an elite university kind of an accent or, you know, that kind of thing. I think that's a good way for dubs to operate generally, because the audience isn't going to get it otherwise.
I think so, because we've been doing that since time out of mind, because like I remember that's like a thing in Shakespearean theater where they're like when they're doing like Romans versus Spartans, they'll give the Spartans a Scottish accent and the Romans an English accent. Okay. To show that, like, there's a cultural difference there.
That's what they did in, I think, Ben-Hur, Spartacus. They did something mm-hmm. like that, where the Romans had English accents and the provincials all had American accents.
That scans.
But it's, you know, it works. We're a whole bunch of
hillbillies here, so.
Well, it works for... I think it worked especially in that movie, but you can have fun if you don't overthink. Hey, you know, like I remember there was a David Spade bit where he was talking. He was commenting on must have been the TV show Spartacus or Rome. I don't know which it was. It was probably Rome. But he was saying, hey, why does everybody have an English accent in this show? They should have Italian accents. They're from Italy. And so they did like a clip where they're just speaking, you know, it's like a Rome scene where they have Italian, but like New York Italian, not like Italian.
Oh, jeez. It just plays like The Sopranos.
Yeah, it was funny. It was funny. But yeah, so anyways, I don't know. What else do we want to cover with this movie?
Oh, geez.
Did we talk about the comparisons to Road Warrior and Mad Max?
A little bit. We touched on that here and there.
Yeah, just a bit, though. After having just watched Mad Max and the Road Warrior, like, you can see, like, because I'm a huge Fist of the North Star guy. Like, my game is basically, like, a tribute to Fist of the North Star, right? So, like, I love the whole Enterprise. I'm smitten with it. But I like the Road Warrior too, and I like them in from very different places. You know, I was surprised because, I mean, Fist of the North Star is kind of it's raison d'etre is about punching people and having their head explode. Like that's the core thing about it, right? But that's really not what the Road Warrior is about. Like there's terrible violence in the Road Warrior, but it's not about the terrible violence. It's kind of about humanity. Whatever you have to contrast it in a extreme situation, you know, like Road Warrior is really big on that. Mad Max is gigantic on that. But like, I don't know, like there's no old world for Kenshiro. Like when you get to his backstory, it's just I was a martial artist and I had a girlfriend and this guy beat me up. And that's backstory, right? There's nowhere near the depth that you have with Max. Like Max has an entire life. Like you feel like he's a person, you know. Kenshiro feels like a cartoon character, which he is, but like it just doesn't have the depth to it, and it's because it's not interested in that, you know. That's not what it's about. We're not here to see the humanity of Ken on display. We're here to see Ken flex his shirt off and then wata 50 or 60 guys and watch them explode in the background.
I mean, I thought the backstory was fine. That wouldn't have been equivalent.
It's serviceable.
Yeah.
But I mean, I wouldn't call anything more than serviceable. The creation of the character of Max is actually, like, that's a piece of cinema, right? Like, that's a truly impressive feat of creating a human being and then destroying him on camera and then watching him slowly get put back together through the course of those two movies. It's brilliant, right? And I almost feel like the Max we get in Thunderdome, which we haven't done Thunderdome yet, but like the Max we get in Thunderdome where he's kind of beyond that point. He's gotten beyond Thunderdome. Right? When you're talking about beyond Thunderdome. But like that Max is almost like a caricature of the ones in the first two movies.
Yeah, definitely. Definitely. It's the version of Max with all the rough edges filed off. It's and that always happens in part three. The same thing happened to Daniel in the Karate Kid Part 3.
Mm-hmm.
The rough edges all get filed off because they need the character to be more palatable to a broad audience.
That's the vibe you get out of it. And that's kind of what we get with Ken, right?
Well, they made Daniel less palatable, I think, by doing it in that case. But
I would agree with you because then he's just whiny.
Yeah, he's just not relatable anymore. It's as it comes time, we don't want to go on.
No, but it's a worthy topic.
Yeah.
Well, and those are both 80s kung fu properties, right? So I mean, it's a reasonable comparison here. So I think that's a reasonable ground. So I feel like Kenshiro as a character is a lot more in the line of the Mad Max Beyond Thunderdome Max than he is from the original one. Like, the original Max felt like a complete character with a complete arc, and really, and across the first two movies, a brilliantly realized arc. Having watched them back to back now, man, they did a fantastic job with him, right? But with Kenshiro, he almost has a flat arc. Right? You almost kind of don't want to see him get with Julia because, like, it's, what's he going to do after that? I'm going to raise my kids, get me a beer. Like, what does this guy do for work? His whole thing is going through the wasteland and punching people, you know? The thing with Julia is, like, when he loses her as a motivation in the manga, he gains this broader wander the wasteland motivation, which is exactly what Mad Max has by the time we get to him in Beyond Thunderdome, right? So that's what's great about Kenshiro as a character. He is unattached, you know, he's just this lone wolf that rolls up and fists whatever problem that people have. Yeah, someone ought to use that phrase for something.
Well, no, I like the fact that that's the character in this movie. I mean, again, I was confused by a lot of things, but I wasn't confused about him. He was a character that I immediately understood. And I think that I even kind of like the fact that it sounds a little juvenile when you put it into words, but that he gets beat up and his girlfriend gets taken by this other guy. Do you know what I mean?
It's juvenile.
Yeah, it's a very very 80s movie kind of thing that you might see. You know what I mean? Just sort of like, well, she's mine now, like a Biff Tannen type of move, right? But
it's a total Biff Tannen move.
Yeah. But I did like that. I was like, oh man, is this guy dead? Like, clearly, he's got to be dead, right? And then that he comes back. I thought that was pretty cool.
I love the scene where he comes back, too, because he literally walks face first through a collapsing building and bisects it. And then the like, five or six dudes who are harassing children see this, and their thought is, I can take this guy.
There are a lot of way too confident people in this movie.
Yeah.
Which is standard fare for any martial arts movie. But I always love that you'll get this guy that is clearly just like mediocre or maybe not even mediocre. And they've just, and some guy wanders in who obviously has massive skills and they're just like, nope, I'm going to, you know, you prepare to die, buddy. I'm going to take you. Well, and
my favorite part of this movie is whenever there's a scene later on in this movie where you've still got goons versus super powerful martial artists, right? It's whenever Rao's army is attacking the other army and the guy turns his body into iron and he's like 30 feet tall and he's walking through and he's killing people and he kills a whole like battalion of them. And the next battalion hesitates. They're like, I don't know, should we go fight this guy, Lord Rao? It looks like we're just doomed here. And his second in command is like, no, go fight, you cowards. I loved that moment because, like, that's the moment when they're like, you know, we're a great army and all that, but that guy is like Godzilla. I don't think this is going to happen.
I think I got to single out a good Rao moment in this movie, too. The first time during the big final fight, the first time when he gets Sanjiro down on the ground and, you know, they've been battling and Sanjiro goes down and he's kind of like, he's like, you know, wheezing and he's clearly in pain. He's almost like panicky. And then he starts to calm down and relax. And it's the thing going through my head watching it is like knowing all this pressure point stuff that, you know, Kenjiro does all the time. It's like, he doesn't know if he's dead yet. It's like, am I going to drop dead in 5 seconds? Like, it's like, he's in this pain. And then it's like, okay, great. I'm not dead. It's like he hasn't already killed me.
Excellent.
Yeah, maybe I was projecting it, but that was totally what I got out of that moment. That was just
happening there. Because, like, even whenever he's done with his whole character arc and he's forgiven like he's decided to go and seek forgiveness, and he turns around to leave. His shoulder explodes, and he's like, "Ah, damn it! Yeah, I'm still dying."
That's right.
Like, I just love how ridiculous their kung fu is. I also love that they escalate all the way up to this like glowing, magical, ridiculous level at the end of that fight. You know, the escalation in this movie is fantastic.
Yeah, I appreciated it.
God, okay, again, it's probably been too long. I could literally talk about this movie until the heat up. I love it so much. I think that we have like three different degrees of having enjoyed this movie. Like, I think that poor Brendan is on the nadir, and then you're like right in the middle, and then I'm like all positivity. I think
you love it this much. That's how much you love it.
Yeah,
I dedicated his RPG
5 years of my life and thousands of words to making my own interview. So I'm a little kooky for him. I'm cuckoo for Punchy Puffs. Anyway. Yeah. But unless you guys have some wonderful insight that you have been holding off to the very last moment, I think we can probably stick a fork in this one.
Yeah, I think we're all set. Do we? By the way, do we know what our next movie is going to be? I don't know if we discussed that or not, but
I knew we were going to do Die Hard at some point. I think they were on the 8th day of Fistmas. So I was looking through our previous episodes during a lull, and I think we're on 8. So we've only got 4 more if we want to take it all the way to 12 days of Fistmas. Up to you guys. I know
we have to get another Bruce Lee movie in.
We need another Bruce Lee movie. I wouldn't mind doing.
And we also have not done a proper Wuxia movie. That's another thing. I don't believe.
So Bruce Lee, Wuxia, Die Hard, and one more.
Only one more.
I think so.
Because I think we're watching Killer Clans now. If we need a Wuxia movie, I'm enjoying that.
Killer Clans is a great movie. I would say we should either go with a Better Tomorrow is going to be hard for everybody to see because I don't think that's available on a lot of platforms anymore. So I would say Kill Bill or French Connection.
Ooh, Kill Bill, dude.
Kill Bill is on TV today, actually. I was watching part of that. And yeah, I'd be up for watching that again, definitely.
Okay, do you want to do part one or part two? Part two is way more Wuxia than
we got to do both. You can't just do one Kill Bill.
You got to do the whole thing? Hell yeah.
It's only one movie. Anyone calling it two movies doesn't know what they're talking about.
I would say definitely both.
It really
both.
Feels like a double
feature. I prefer
grindhouse it.
I prefer the second film in the series, but I think generally people prefer the first one has been my experience when I've talked to folks.
I would say the second one's heavier than the first one. The first one's like almost just action, right? Radical. And the second one's a lot more like, let's go into the backstory. Let's go into the character motivations. Let's do more drama, more dramatic work.
It's got essential parts, though, like her training sequence and everything that I feel like you can't even really do the movie without that stuff.
I'm with you. I feel like you have to have the whole experience. So
having to watch both movies in 1 week would not be an intolerable punishment for me. I'm perfectly
fine with watching them. Let's watch them in one day.
Well, yeah, that too. It'd probably be
all
fun.
Right. So I guess we'll be back with one of those movies, and we will. Until next time, we will talk to you later.
Great.